after it. An importer, a beautiful woman, a nut, and a guy I couldn't figure out. But before we were through, one was in the hospital, two were in the morgue, and the fourth was waiting for the hangman. All that because of a blue burgonette, which was something I'd never even heard of before.
From the pen of Raymond Sandler, outstanding author of crime fiction, comes this famous character. The Adventures of Philip Marlowe. Gerald Moore, starred as Philip Marlowe, we bring you tonight's exciting story, The Blue Burgonette.
The knock on my glass-paneled office door sounded like a fresh-out-of-Yale insurance salesman making his first enthusiastic call of the morning. Yet when the door swung open, I was surprised to see a man with no more height and weight than a jockey, and all the boyish bounce of a New Year's Day hangover. He was about 40, and too carefully groomed. From pearl gray Hamburg through pearl gray stickpin to pearl gray spats. But when he started to talk, each sentence held too much self-assurance, and I didn't like it.
My name is Norman Borin. I'm an importer located here in Los Angeles, in San Francisco, and in the area.
I'm Philip Marlowe, private detective, located all in one place, which means that your rent bill is higher than mine, and that's all.
I have little time for flippancy, Mr.
And I have less time for high-handedness. I don't make ends meet by pulling a rickshaw either, Mr. Voorhees. Cigarette?
I don't... Thank you. Mr. Marlowe, I need an escort for a crate of rare silks, which is to be flown to San Francisco tonight.
At 25 a day plus expenses, I could be your man. Why so much fuss over a few bolts of silk?
In this case, it's the embroidery on the material. A very rare and very intricate Chinese design.
Which, in basic English, means what?
Oh, come, come, Marlowe. The silk was legitimately purchased at a low figure. And a profitable resale is my only object.
Then why the pistol packing routine?
Because I was forced to outsmart a half dozen competitors to get this material.
There are poor losers in every business, is that it?
Exactly. Now, will you take the job?
All right, where do I report and when?
At my warehouse on South Figueroa at 9 tonight. Here's my card. Either my assistant, Miss Sandra Lane, or I will be on hand.
Fine. Oh, and by the way, Mr. Voorhees, I didn't mean to snap your head off when you first walked in. It's just that I'm quick to resent being pushed around.
Don't apologize, Mr. Marlowe. If you hadn't been that quick, I wouldn't have hired you. Good day, sir.
Stared at the decollete card Voorhees had given me and smiled until the staccato report of his built-up heels had faded down the corridor. I dropped the card into my pocket, punched out a couple of overdue letters on my Remington Rand, and left the office for lunch. Outside, the sun was too high and the smog too low for local comfort. So, with nothing to do until 9, I decided to drive out to the pier in Santa Monica, where I could eat French fried shrimp and watch the seagulls collect overhead and swear at me. But when I got to my car and opened the door, I suddenly forgot about lunch. Because a man was crossed inside my car waiting with a gun in his hand.
Get in, Marlowe, quickly. Then start the car and drive until I tell you to stop.
What are we going
to
do about the red lights, bud? Hurdle them?
Marlowe, start the car or I'll kill you.
That's nice and congenial of him. Okay, where to?
Just drive and listen carefully. I'm a foreigner.
No.
Yes. My name is Leonardo Baltierra. Does that mean anything to you?
Frankly, no. Then again, I haven't checked the Rogues Gallery in almost a month.
Stop it, Marlowe. I haven't traveled the width of this country without a moment's sleep to hear empty words. Now, where is the blue burgonette?
The blue what?
The burgonette. The blue burgonette, Marlowe. Where is it?
Look, Baltierra, maybe you have all your marbles and maybe you don't. But either way, believe me, I've never heard of a burgonette, red, white, or blue.
Don't lie to me, Marlowe. With my own eyes, I saw him going to your office. Voorhees.
Voorhees? What's he got to do with it?
Everything. He stole the burgonette from me. You know that.
Voorhees never mentioned such a thing to me.
You lie. I only been here in Los Angeles an hour, but already I know that Voorhees has the burgonette. And I swear by all that's holy, it will be in my hands where it belongs before morning. And if you don't... Marlowe, watch out. Watch out.
I just had my fender straightened out.
All right, pull over there.
Don't move, Marlon. Don't move. I still got the gun and I still shoot. Now remember, I'll be back for the burger ladder because it's mine. And I'll never rest until it's safely here in my hands.
Before I could make a pass at Baltieri, he was gone. I apologized to the cop, the truck driver, and the gaping mob that was disappointed not to find me bleeding, and then I went for a telephone to call Mr. Voorhees and complain about a madman, a blue burgonette, whatever that was, and a pleated fender. But there was no answer at the warehouse. A fistful of nickels disappeared before I finally found an importer who knew that Voorhees lived at 1330 North Camden Drive in Beverly Hills. Half hour later, I turned onto a gravel driveway and crunched to a stop in front of a house which was redwood and glass, and guess where the front door is. The landscaping consisted of a mess of severely clipped trees that even Joyce Kilmer would have turned his back on. When I leaned against the front doorbell, a slew of Chinese gongs rang someplace deep inside, and I was ready for at least two man shoes when the door eased open noiselessly. Oh, the collection of beautiful things that stood 5.5 feet above the threshold was about as Chinese as a butterscotch sundae, and had a complexion to match. Her waistline was rye crisp and lettuce leaf, but the rest of her, strictly steak and potato. Her eyes were something a little greener than envy. And when she spoke, I couldn't figure out what Voorhees wanted with a bunch of old Oriental chimes.
You always stare like that.
Well, it's more polite than panting. Besides, you were surprised. I expected either Voorhees or something with a moon face and a kimono. Now, may I come in? Sandra.
How did you know my name?
I get around.
Oh, you must be Mr. Marlowe.
Uh-huh.
Please come in. Mr. Voorhees is finishing some business in the study, but I'm... Oh, here he is now.
Yes, I'm sure we'll both be more than satisfied with it.
Yes, of course we will. The arrangements suit you, Norman. They're bound to make me happy.
You're always happy, Goody.
Oh, Mr. Marlowe.
Uh-huh.
Well, I didn't expect you. Excuse me a moment, please.
Sure.
Well, today I'll see both you and the man tonight.
Right. We'll be waiting side by side. Well, goodbye, Norman.
Who's laughing, boy?
I don't know. I haven't seen through Mr. Voorhees' personal mail yet today.
Another? You're in the wrong place at the wrong time. What's the trouble?
A blue burgonette.
A what?
Oh, that again. What do you know about the burgonette, Marlowe?
Nothing, but a nut with a gun in his hand wouldn't believe that. Now, you tell me, just what is a blue burgonette, Mr. Voorhees?
It's an ancient ceremonial helmet.
Oh, you mean that knight in armor stuff? One of those tin cans with a hinged front for picking your teeth?
Yes, but this particular helmet was only ornamental. It's made of solid gold and covered with jewels. It was completed in 1560 by none other than the great Italian master, Benvenuto Cellini. The entire helmet, or burgonette as that particular style is called, is decorated with a brilliant blue enamel, also the work of Cellini. And it hasn't lost its luster even to this day.
That's very interesting. What's it worth, the gold and the jewels on it, I mean?
Oh, $30,000-$40,000. But that's merely its intrinsic value. As an art relic, it's almost priceless. However, the last time I heard of the burgonette was in Italy before the war.
Yeah, but the man with the gun doesn't believe that. He thinks you've got it in your hip pocket.
But then the man with the gun must be Leonardo Baltieri.
That's right. How'd you know?
Because the great uncle of Baltieri was the last rightful owner of the burgonette. And Baltier has his own interpretation of the laws of primogeniture. He shows up periodically to threaten, sue, and spy on importers the world over. He's practically an international joke.
Yes, well, I find it hard to laugh at screwballs when my clients lie to me. Mind if I see the bill of lading on the silk?
Sandra, show Mr. Marlowe all the papers on the silk transaction.
Yes, of course.
I hate to see him in doubt this way. It obviously distresses him so.
Papers that look more involved in the semi-annual report of the United States Gypsum Company. I pored over them until it was obvious to even the jade Buddhas in the room that my real interest wasn't in any figure on paper. And then I left. When I got into my car and rolled out of the driveway onto Camden, a black coupe pulled up sharply on the other side of the street. A long, thin face that was jacking up a nut sandy head as Duffin Ottoman stared at me like I was a cyclops wearing harlequins. And he didn't let it go at that. Because when I turned towards Sunset, he swung around and followed. It stayed that way until we were out of Beverly Hills and along the strip. By then, I got curious to see just how far he'd go. So I signaled for a stop with all the subtlety of a Cub Scout sending his first message by semaphore, and I pulled up in front of a sandwich shop. A minute after I entered and sat down at the counter, Sandy Hair joined me. When we each had a steaming cup of coffee in front of us, he opened up.
You mind passing the sugar, fella?
Not at all. Now, do you mind telling me why I'm being tailed?
Huh?
Come on, tit for tat, you've got the sugar.
Okay. I saw you coming out of Norman Voorhees' place in Beverly Hills. Now, what's he to you?
I could say it was my mother, but you wouldn't believe me.
I'm wasting my time.
Mm-hmm.
Are you interested in making a lot of money for a little information?
A reward, you might say? Always. Information about what?
A blue burgonet.
Say, I know a guy you ought to know. His name's Leonardo Valtierra, and blue burgonets are his hobby.
Matter of fact, you might even say that he's crazy about them.
I'm shoving off, alone. Sandy Hare didn't bat an eye at the mention of Valtierra's name. But it didn't prove anything, and I knew that I'd still have to wait until 9 o'clock when I was due at the warehouse on Figueroa before I could start adding things up. It was only 5 then, so I went back to my apartment, showered, shaved, and grabbed a little sleep. And then after stopping off on La Brea at a prefabricated bit of old Spain, where I had a glass of stale Mexican beer, I took a cab to South Figueroa in the Crate of Silk. The place was a narrow, gray-curtained storefront that widened in the rear to a warehouse. From the modest half-inch-high gold letters and Voorhees importer, I gathered that my client didn't care much for the off-the-street trade. It was exactly 9 o'clock when I knocked. It was 2 minutes after 9, and the knuckles on my right hand were bruised before a light went on inside. And Sandra Lane came to the door.
Oh, Phil, I'm so glad you're here.
Why? The price of silk dropping?
Please, Phil, don't joke. I've had nothing but strange noises in this warehouse ever since Mr. Voorhees left. Why, I finally locked myself in.
Where is Voorhees?
He had a phone call right after dinner. Something important. He asked me to wait for you.
No? Where's the silk?
In the back in the crate. Come on, let's hurry.
All
right. It's gone better off you. There's a truck and a driver waiting outside in the alley. Here's a bill of lading for the pilot of the plane. Phil.
What is it?
You'll be very careful, won't you?
Why, Sandra, when you say it like that, how else can I be? Come on, baby, smile. After all, it's only a bolt of silk. Or is it? The truck driver was all muscle and about as chatty as a Vermont farmer with laryngitis. 15 minutes later, when we pulled up at the airfield, we learned that our plane wouldn't be in for another half hour. I knew any scheduled delay, the two-plane, one-hangar grass-covered runway could mean anything from 60 minutes on up. So I sent the driver to scrounge some coffee, and I got out of the cab to stretch.
That's fine, Marlo.
What?
Just keep them up.
Oh, well, Sandy Hair. What happened? Couldn't you come to terms with my friend Valtierra?
I didn't try. It looked like you'd lead me to what I wanted. Now it seems as though I'm right.
Oh, you're not talking about this box here, are you?
Nothing else but, Marlo. And at this point, it would kill me to see it get into anyone else's hands.
Then die!
Valtierra!
Yes, Valtierra. And just in time to save everything that means anything to me. That pig, Hamilton. I should have done that to him a week ago in New York. It would have been simpler that way. No, you, Marlowe, get in that truck.
Wait a minute, Valtierra. We've gone riding together before. It didn't do either of us any good.
I know, Marlowe, I know. But you didn't have the blue burgonet all wrapped up with you then, eh? Nine.
Okay. Where are we going?
Away, any place. Just so I can get the burgonet out of that ugly crate without interference from anyone, including you, Marlo.
Valtierra focused the muzzle of his gun in close to my right ear. Grinning like Svengali on Trilby's opening night, he put his foot on top of mine and shoved hard. The accelerator went to the floor and stayed there.
They thought they were so clever, those fools. Keep on this road until I tell you to turn.
You're in for a big disappointment, Valtierra. There's silk in that box, that's all.
You've been misled, Marlo. The silk is nothing but camouflage for the burgundy. Oh, Voorhees is a shrewd little man, all right.
What makes you think Voorhees had it?
Because someone got it away from Hamilton just a few minutes ahead of me in New York. Hamilton knew who it was. I followed him, and he led me straight to Voorhees.
You've been a busy little bee, haven't you?
It's been harder than I anticipated. My original plan was subtle and perfect. I even sent my wife away on an extended vacation so they wouldn't be able to get at me to her. Turn right on this side of the road, eh?
You better let me slow down a little. We'll never make it.
All right. But not three. They can't strip me of money and position, but they can't keep me from the symbol of Valtierra power.
Can't buy much power these days for 30,000 bucks. That's what your fancy war bonnet's worth.
Oh, to you cattle, yeah. But the blood of ancestors that built an empire flows in my veins. To me, the Burgundy is the heart and soul of a tradition that will never die. I'm penniless now, but that golden helmet will be the source of an inspiration that will recreate the grandeur of my ancient family.
Oh, brother, are you wound up? You'll need a balcony and 8 inches more chin to get away with that routine. Oh,
shut up. Stop over there under those trees and do just as I said.
All right. Now what?
Get out on this side. Now push that box off onto the ground.
Aren't you afraid I might bend up your precious heirloom?
Here is a tire iron. Rip the lid off. And a bullet flies fast, so don't try anything foolish.
All right.
Yeah. That's enough. It's loose. I'll be very pleased to do the rest to myself. Stand back, then. Oh, I've waited for this moment. No, it can't be. Boris.
Norman Boris.
He's dead. You tricked me. The Burgundy's
gone. Wait a minute. I didn't do that.
You fool. You killed the only man who knew where the Burgundy had to see them. He must be...
Look. He's moving.
What's that?
No. When he turned to look, his jaw swung broadside to me, and I hung an hour never right on it that piled him into a heap behind the box. I took a quick look to be sure Boris was really dead. Then it struck me that whoever had popped him for shipment would go for Sandra next. I jumped into the truck and went back to the Figueroa warehouse, wide open. A single light still burned in the back. So I parked the truck and started around on foot. The side door was ajar, and when I looked in, I saw Sandra backed against the wall by a man holding her at gunpoint. It was the sandy-haired Mr. Hamilton. I couldn't hear what was being said until I eased the door open. Enough to get inside.
I don't know. Really, I don't.
Look, sister, you might as well tell me because I'm not leaving here until I know what's happened to the Burgundy.
Please, I told you. I don't know anything about it.
You're lying. Boris got it and you know it. Now, where is it? What was that?
Look out, Sandra! Come on. That's all. Drop it. No, you don't. Drop it.
Oh, Dylan, you all right?
Yeah. Hey, miss me. It's kind of funny, though, how he collapsed all at once. I expected a real fight.
It might be a trick.
No, look at his face, like wet ashes. The guy's out cold. He really looks sick. Name's Hamilton, but who is he, anyhow?
I have no idea. All I know is he came in with that gun in his hand while I was waiting here for Mr. Voorhees.
Voorhees? You had a long wait, baby. Voorhees is dead.
Oh, no.
Yeah, I carried his body out of here myself in that box we thought was full of silk.
Murdered?
That's right.
Oh.
Incidentally, Sandra, do you always wait around with your coat over your arm?
Well, no, I... Let me... Oh, Phil, I'm scared. I've got to tell you the truth now. Mr. Voorhees had the blue burgundy. He said he bought it from someone, I don't know who. That shipment of silk to San Francisco was only a decoy to get Baltierra and this man Hamilton off the trail.
Uh-huh. Baltierra was decoyed to a vacant lot all of 10 whole minutes from here. Hamilton's right in our lap and Voorhees is dead. Fine. But those boys are playing for keeps. Where's the burgundy now?
I don't know. Please, Phil, believe me, I don't know anything more than that. I'm afraid. I want to get out of here. Out of this helmet. Listen.
All right, Sandra. I got his gun. Let's bring him to and find out what his wrinkle is. Got some water handy? His head's been cut.
Yes, there's water in the back. I'll go get some.
Thanks. Okay, come on, Hamilton. Wake up. Come on. Come to life. Sandra! Scream jerked me to my feet. I made an end run around a line of Ming barges and dashed to the back door as the motor roared off down the alley. I got to where I could see a pair of taillights were just winking out of sight around the corner. And even before I turned, I heard another car coming up behind me. It was blacked out, and Leonardo Baltierra looked like a ghost that had just seen a ghost. He was at the wheel. I dived for cover as he threw some bullets in my general direction. Then he tunneled fast into an alley after the first car, leaving nothing but dusty darkness behind him. I'd been as outclassed as a stutterer at an auction. I figured if I wanted to see Sandra's green eyes again, which I did, I'd better pry some fast answers out of Mr. Hamilton. lying on a pair of rubber legs when I got to him, but I didn't give him the benefit of any doubt.
Where's the girl? What happened back there?
Nothing, just kidnapping, reckless driving, and assault with a deadly weapon, and I'm in the same mood, so don't move until I finish calling the police.
The police? You're going to call the law?
Yeah. And then you're going to give out with some straight information, and if you don't think I mean it, just try getting tongue-tied and see what happens.
Oh, wait a minute, Marlowe. We've been wasting a lot of each other's time here. My membership card.
H.J. Hamilton, investigator. Office of the curator, Italo Hispanic Museum in Chicago.
Well, I was suspicious of you at first, Marlowe. Yet all the time you were on the same team and didn't know it.
I hope the outside world never hears about this. Okay, Hamilton, how does the real story go?
Like this, 1, 2, 3. The museum inherited the Cellini helmet known as the Blue Brilliant from its owner, Alessandro Baltiero, who was killed in the war. He was Leonardo Baltiero's great-uncle, and he disinherited that bug years ago. I located the helmet in Italy and brought it to New York last week. It was stolen from me there, and everything points to one man as the thief.
Mm-hmm.
That's Norman Voorhees. And when we find him...
Whoa, Voorhees is dead.
You sure?
I'm positive. His body was in the box at the airport.
Leonardo Baltiero.
No. Baltiero found the body, and it almost shocked him out of his accent. Look, what do you know that I don't about Sandra Lane?
Nothing. She's Voorhees' assistant, that's all.
She knows her boss had the helmet. She's in plenty of trouble right now. We better punch a hole in this setup and quick.
You're right. That shipment of silk was a sidetracker, wasn't it?
Mm-hmm. For you and Baltiero.
And a big piece of this thing is missing, Marlowe. There must be somebody else involved that we don't know about.
Yeah. With you out of his hair, Voorhees undoubtedly intended to get rid of the Bergenet tonight. Ooh.
Wait a minute. He did have an appointment tonight.
Where? Who with?
What was that guy's name? The red-faced, fat, the real laughing boy. I heard his name once.
Ruddy complexion, jovial.
Yeah.
Could it be Corday?
Corday. That's it.
Spence, and we suspect a big one. Left Chicago 3 months ago. Lives in Beverly Hills now.
Uh-huh.
I've got an address on
him. Oh, good. Come on, find it.
Here.
621 North Maple. It's a long shot.
Well, what can we lose at this point? Besides, it's about our turn for a break.
Hey, you really look beat. You sure you can make it?
I wouldn't miss it for anything. Let's go. We got into the black drive-it-yourself coupe Hamilton had rented and made for Beverly Hills. I drove because he was still slightly green from that crack on the head Baltiero had given him at the airstrip. When we turned into North Maple Drive, only one of the half a dozen houses on the block had a light burning. As we got nearer, that blinked out. It was number 621. I went around a corner to be out of sight from the house and stopped the car.
The light going out might have been a coincidence, Marlowe, but let's not count on it.
In this corner with a button, I wouldn't count on my own father. Now, look, Hamilton, you're not too chipper, so I'll go in.
All right.
But as soon as I'm up to the door, you give me some close support from that big front window, or our brother act might get the hook before we get out of the wings. Now, remember... Whatever I do, I'll bank on your covering me, okay?
Yeah, okay, Marlowe. And for comfort, keep your collar open. You're liable to get a very warm reception.
I walked around the corner, cut diagonally across the street, and went up the steps to the heavy panel door. I glanced back once and saw Hamilton moving slowly next to a high hedge that kept him hidden from anyone inside the house watching. I waited a moment and got a grip on my gun and then knocked good and loud. I waited again and listened, but nothing happened. From then on, I knew it was a trap. I felt as comfortable as the last man in a round of Russian roulette. I was sure even before I touched the handle, the door was going to be unlocked. Yeah, it was. I ducked low and stepped into one side fast. Then I pressed my back against the wall and moved along the short hallway to the living room. Still nothing happened. A faint light that filtered in through the big front window fell across something on the floor. It took me several seconds to figure out that it was a body. I looked at the window again and saw Hamilton move outside, so it was time for light. I felt for a switch, found one, turned it on. Body on the floor was Baltiero. He'd been shot. I walked clear across the room and bent over him before Corday made his move.
You've got two choices, laddie. Drop your pistol and stand up, or hang on to it and lay down beside that fella on the floor there.
Thanks, I'll stand.
You behave very well for a party crasher.
And you throw rough parties. Did you do it, Corday?
No, he didn't.
Hello?
I did, Marlowe. I had to.
Sandra.
A few minutes ago, my husband broke in here and tried to kill me. That's why I had to kill him.
Your husband?
Yes. I'm Mrs. Leonardo Baltiero.
You're also a clumsy, hot-headed vixen.
Oh, stop it. Could I help it? You sent me for water at the warehouse tonight, Marlowe. I took that opportunity to get away because I had the helmet in the trunk of my car. I practically fell over Leonardo outside. When he saw me there, he realized I'd been working with Voorhees right from the start. He was murderous.
But you didn't have to lead him here and kill him on my living room floor.
You're a real sweetheart, you are, baby. And you killed Voorhees too, huh?
Yes. I went in with him because that idiot husband of mine would let me starve rather than sell the Bergenet if he got it. But Voorhees was greedy. He double-crossed me by trying to sell it to Corday here without me. Once the jewels were stripped and the gold melted down, the trail would end, of course. I would be out.
And that would have been fine by me. Norman Voorhees, at least, was a very deep, efficient little man.
And he's a very dead little man, so shut up about it. I'm getting nervous. Let's get rid of Marlowe here some way and finish our business.
Not so fast. You made a fine mess of things. Murder on the floor, private dicks in the house. How can I stay in my business with things like that happening? Now, before we settle anything else, we're going to clean it all up. Here, girl, take my gun. You're handy with them. All right, Marlowe, take the dead man's shoulder.
Oh, sure.
We're going to carry him out back to my car.
Oh, of course. Anything to help out.
Wait.
Huh?
I might have known it. That's what I get for dealing with amateurs.
What's the matter now?
Look at him. He wants to go outside. Well, don't you get it yet? He's got help out there.
Hamilton?
That's right, kid.
You scatterbrained fool, Sandra. You got me into this.
Stay back, Corday.
Give me that gun.
No.
Now, stay where you are. Both of you. Keep your hands up, Corday. Okay, Hamilton. You can come in now. Everything's under control. Hamilton.
Hamilton?
Huh?
Oh, Marlowe. What happened?
What happened? Where were you?
Well, I guess the minute I got here to the window, I must have passed out.
Oh, fine. I was in here making brave, and you were out there, passed out cold. I slept in the next day and didn't get to my office until afternoon. I found then that Hamilton had been calling all morning. When I returned his call, he said that on his recommendation, the museum would pay me $25 a day plus expenses to deliver the Blue Bergenet to Chicago. He added that I had nothing to worry about because it would be packed in a well-labeled box to look like a shipment of Hickok belts and garters. But Hamilton was calling from the hospital. He had a fractured skull from the blow Valkyra had given him at the airport. So I'm going to take the job, all right. But just as a safety measure, I'm not going to carry that helmet in any box. I'm going to wear it.
The Adventures of Philip Marlowe, created by Raymond Chandler, stars Gerald Moore and is produced and directed by Norman MacDonald. Featured in tonight's cast were Betty Lou Gerson, Hans Conried, Alan Reed, Louis Van Ruten, and Howard McNair. The special music was conceived and conducted by Richard O'Rant. Be sure to be with us again next week when Philip Marlowe says...
Strange things were going on that night. There was a wild stallion waiting in a garage, a gladiator with a chip on his shoulder, and a nasty storm brewing overhead. All I had to do was keep an angel out of trouble, and that sounded easy. Until I found out that even an angel can be too hot to handle. The Adventures...
Now, living out in the open in the summer is fine. But living in the open in winter is quite a different matter. But that's exactly where you'll find millions of people in Europe and Asia. And many of those living outside are children. Support the Crusade for Children. Remember, the Crusade for Children represents 26 long-established relief agencies. Your gift goes to all these agencies. This is CBS, the Columbia Broadcasting System.
KNX Los Angeles, AM and FM.